such as Edmund Knowles, again from Lisson in County Tyrone, was even less fortunate because Knowles, who was a blacksmith, was forced to work in his trade by the rebels. So these were kind of some of the common reports. The Ulster depositions are also quite a challenging source in terms of the widespread reference that they make to a lot of very anti-Protestant activities by newly Catholic rebels. And this is something that I've written an article on with a colleague of mine who also worked on the project, Elaine Murphy, recently. But the descriptions of the destructions of Protestant objects were frequent. And Bibles, for example, were something that were most commonly destroyed. Alexander Crichton, for example, who was from County Monaghan, described how the Irish rebels destroyed his Bibles at Glasslough, burning two or three of them, as well as the service books. And the abuse often went even further than just the pure destruction. This deposition by Thomas Chambers of Armagh notes that the desecration of a Bible by Patrick Carroll O'Cullen, and it was even more disturbing than usual. And I quote, being demanded whether they went to Mass to the Church of Feehill, who made answer that it was a place fit for him, and that finding the Bible in the church, he tore it and pissed in it. So these kind of images were very common. Further incidences related to the desecration of Protestant graves by the Catholic Irish rebels in County Fermanagh, Catherine Madison, the widow of Peter Madison, reveals the ill treatment of her husband and his corpse. She described a very horrific death, followed by which he was hacked and mangled. But not content that he was actually dead, the rebels went a fortnight after he was buried and dug up his grave just to make sure. And again, he was then left uncovered in the landscape. Now again, these are quite horrific. We don't often know, these are kind of events that happen. We need to judge by looking at several depositions to see whether a number of people actually make the similar report. But while these kinds of incidences were fairly bleak and fairly horrendous, the deponents did also report that they received a great deal of assistance on their way. Many acknowledged that both the Gaelic Irish and other settler families came to their aid. I recently argued elsewhere in an article that towns, for example, in Ulster served as centres of sanctuary during the rebellion for displaced settlers. And that was particularly evident here in Ulster, where towns like Virginia and County Cavan became centres of refuge as people fled. George Crichton, again, I think his was the longest deposition on record, who was a Scottish minister, deposed that many of those who fled, for example, from Newtown, County Fermanagh, arrived in Virginia and were put into the empty houses and fed by the people of Virginia. And he reckoned that on one particular day, he had actually provided food for 450 people as they fled to Dublin through County Cavan. That's not an unusual event. John Seaman, for example, from County Cavan, again deposed that his wife and brother's child had fled to Castle Crohan in County Fermanagh on the outbreak of rebellion and had continued to live quite successfully in the castle for about 8 months and, you know, were protected in a way from the rebellion. And even they reported that Irish people had given them aid, Gaelic Irish had given them aid as they went about their way to Dublin. So most people know these kind of stories about the depositions. That's what they're sort of famous for, and in a way why they are quite controversial. Again, they are controversial because this evidence exists. We don't have a parallel source for the Catholic side, obviously, of the rebellion. This is a mainly Protestant source. So we have to factor all of those things in when we actually look at what happens during 1641. But while the depositions are known for this, I actually think that you can learn a lot more about people in Ulster in the 1640s and a lot more about the plantation society that had developed in Ireland during the previous decades. And again, this becomes evident in a lot of recent work that's been done on depositions. Nicholas Canny has completed a very extensive article on Cork in regards to this, and I recently completed one in Armagh. I kind of concentrated on Armagh because people tend to focus on the massacres in Armagh and the great violence in Armagh, But you could actually pull apart the depositions and find out a lot more about what life would have been like for the average settler at the time. So to give you an example from that work, most of the depositions from Armagh indicated that within Armagh you had a very strong family network within the British settler community. And most deponents made reference to immediate family members, including their wives, husbands, children, and even their wider extensive family. In the study, for example, 18 women deposed during the Dublin Commission, and of those, 14 women also deposed during the Commonwealth Commission. 13 of them said that they were widows, relics, and 5 described themselves as wives. And 4 women actually gave a statement jointly with their husband. So that was quite a common feature in the depositions that people would go in together. Both men and women acknowledged their family members throughout their descriptions. And they also quite often not only gave a description of what they had lost, but also maybe what their elderly father had lost or their mother or so on. Ellen Matchett from Kilmore in Armagh, for example, accounted for the losses sustained by her sister, Joan Constable, who also gave a deposition in the volume, and even talked of the losses of her daughter, Dorothy Matchett, and her son, James Matchett. So you can see the family units breaking down and where they all, for example, lived and what they all owned. Many deponents tell us how many children they had. And for example, Thomas Grundle from Cora in Armagh noted that he had 6 children, and that wasn't an uncommon number. And he tells us even more about his family life, because he tells us his kinship network was expanded to 7 servants in his direct employment. In one instance, a proxy, Gilbert Pemberton, deposed on the behalf of his niece and her husband, who were now in Dublin. And those kind of familial bonds were commonplace. And you can see it not just in sort of that kind of statement, but also in the references that people make to lost inheritance within the depositions. So quite often, for example, deponents would say that because of the rebellion, they had lost their opportunity to gain a quarter of the family farm. So you can learn more about the family network. It appears from the depositions that before the rebellion broke out, that relationships between the settler and the Gaelic Irish community were actually fairly stable. A number of the deponents recorded names of servants that were Gaelic Irish names, and that they had then gone out in rebellion. Richard Newbury in Armagh, for example, noted that one Turlough O'Lorcan and Donal O'Lorcan, his brother, both Irishmen and late servants to this deponent, had now turned rebels and soldiers onto Tuil McCann, who was one of the great rebels. A very sort of strongly Irish name in the 17th century, and unfortunately lost. It would be interesting to see it in common usage now. But their bond to their former master was even more evident in his report, because he noted that when the rebellion broke out, that they came to him and assisted him and told him basically to get out, that this was happening. The depositions provide even further evidence of the wider networks between the people in Ulster. They noted debts they had lost, for example. So it tells us a lot about the indebtedness between the settlers and the Gaelic Irish in Ulster at the time, and the systems of credit that were building up throughout the period. And it's recognisable in frequent references to profits from lease agreements that they were losing. Charity Chapel, for example, in her deposition, acknowledged the dual blow to her debt collection when she stated, and I quote, "There is owing on to her by divers English Protestants, either slain or robbed by the rebels, £253.04. And she later stated that all of her debt books and most of her writings about her debts had actually been burned by the rebels because they were presumably in debt to her. Mulroney Carroll from Castledoe in Donegal also noted his extensive losses, not just in Donegal, but also in Kings County, modern-day County Offaly. So the kind of networks that these people had were right across the country. He was deprived not just of the normal materials in County Donegal, but also seemed to have a farm in Kings County from which he lost cattle, sheep and corn. An examination of those losses in the depositions suggests significant wealth amongst the settler communities. While Mulrani Carroll, for example, lost £1,500, other deponents across Ulster made similar statements. Mary Chessman, who was the widow of William Chessman, who was the minister of the parish of Desert Lynn in County Londonderry, gave an account of the losses that her husband, for example, had sustained. And they included the normal farm goods, right through to jewellery, money and rings, for example, all of which amounted to £800. Other deponents, such as John and James Redfern from Desert Martin, noted that they'd lost houses of Maherfelt worth £210, with a further loss of £100 on the same houses due to the improvements that they had made. And those losses continue throughout the depositions. We can find out an awful lot more about the people as well in terms of the communities they lived in, the rural and the urban communities that emerged in Ulster. The depositions certainly attest to strong agricultural communities, unsurprisingly. In County Fermanagh, numerous deponents identified themselves as husbandmen and yeomen, for example. Richard Colley of Kinlarna in County Fermanagh described himself as a husbandman and listed off his agricultural goods. And he had lost, for example, in all about £65 worth of agricultural goods. Maurice Middlebrook from Drumully in Fermanagh described himself as a yeoman and an English Protestant, and he had lost farm goods again worth £420. It was also quite common to see that sort of agricultural connection outside of traditional agricultural goods or outside traditional agricultural occupations. All of the gentry, for example, often deposed that they would have had corn, cows and so on lost again during the rebellion. One such deposition, for example, was given by a woman called Anne Bastard, who lived in the city of Londonderry. Her husband Thomas Bastard was described as an esquire, and she accounted for her husband's losses in a far-off parish of Dunwest in County Tyrone, as including cows, horses, sheep, corn, hay, household stuff, plate and rings to the value of £350. That's not an uncommon feature. And those losses can tell us an awful lot more about how people lived and how their communities interacted. We can see in sort of the more urban areas of Ulster, for example, that we had even stronger, I'm going to just click through here, that we had even stronger sort of references to urban settlement, suggesting very strong artisan and merchant activity within the towns of Ulster. In Armagh, for example, several deponents listed their occupations as specific crafts, and they can tell us a lot about the instruments that they lost in their trade. So we can learn a little bit about what commercial life was like in the towns of Ulster. Nehemiah Richardson, for example, a tallow chandler, lost tallow, butter and household goods to the value of £310. William Clark in the parish of Loch Gall described himself as a tanner, and he accounted for losses of £150 of his goods. James Shaw from Market Hill in Armagh described himself as an innkeeper, and his losses included things like wine and aquavitae. So quite interesting little details coming out. Merchant activity was also very strong in Ulster, with numerous areas in County Cavan reporting strong merchant activity in particular. Belturbet in Cavan Town, for example, had five deponents, all of whom described themselves as merchants. One of them, John Anderson from Belturbet, deposed that he'd lost over £900 of shopwares. Another, William Smith, also from Belturbet, noted his shop goods, which were really diverse, broadcloths, kerseys, friezes, hops, iron, steel, stockings and tobacco to the value of £300. And that kind of wealth was even further elucidated by him when he described that he'd lost ready money of £150 and debts in his shop accounts of £60. So you can find out an awful lot more about the people of Ulster by reading between the lines of the information. In conclusion then, taken as a whole, the 1641 depositions are quite a unique source for 17th century Ulster and indeed Ireland as a whole. They provide us with descriptions of what happened during the rebellion and what people say happened to them during the rebellion. But I would argue that you can read between the lines to learn an awful lot more about the social world of communities in Ulster prior to the rebellion. It's a very diverse collection, and I think you have to kind of remember those categories when you actually approach them. While the evidence has long been explored, we're hoping that the publication of that evidence online will allow for a much wider range of research, so that people can look at it for family history, local history if they want to find out what happened in their area, but more widely to allow people to make up their own minds and own judgments about what happened in the rebellion in 1641, and to allow people to study more about Plantation Ireland. So I hope that today I've given you a little bit of a taster of what's actually there. I hope I haven't shocked you with some of the gruesome details. It's not all horror stories, but there are some there. So I'd encourage you to look at our website, which is www.1641.tcd.ie, and to give us a like on Facebook if you're on Facebook, where we update it with information from time to time when things actually are happening. And I'm happy to answer questions, obviously, now, and again to show you a little bit about the website live in action. So thank you very much.
Emily, thank you very much.